Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have apologies today from James Dornan and I welcome Evelyn Tweed who will be our substitute today. Our first item of business is the consideration of a negative statutory instrument, the Council Tax Reduction and Council Tax Discount Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2023. This negative instrument is an annual update and it amends three existing principal council tax regulations. The instrument is laid under the negative procedure, which means that its provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to a motion to annul them. No motions to annul have been laid. Do members have any comments on the instrument? No. I invite the committee then to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. Are members content to note the instrument? Yes. Yes. Right, we will move on. Our second item of business today then is an evidence session on the Charities Regulation and Administration Scotland Bill. The Charities Regulation and Administration Scotland Bill was introduced in the Scottish Parliament on the 15th of November 2022, following two consultation exercises by the Scottish Government in 2019 and 2021. The bill aims to strengthen and update the current legislative framework for charities by increasing transparency and accountability. It also aims to make improvements to OSCAR's powers and bring Scottish charity legislation up to date with certain key aspects of regulation in England, Wales and Northern Ireland. Last week we heard from representatives across the third sector, as well as from designated religious charities and a local authority. Today, we will hear from two more panels spanning charity regulation, law, academia, accountancy and audit. And all our witnesses will appear in person. So I will now welcome to the meeting our first panel. We have Martin Tyson, Head of Regulation and Improvement, Office of the Scottish Charity Regulator. We have Alan Eccles, Solicitor Member, Charity Law Subcommittee, Law Society of Scotland, and John Mayton, Assistant Director, Legal Services, Charity Commission for England and Wales. Now, I just have a few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we begin. Please don't feel that you all have to answer every question. If you've nothing new to add to what's already been said, that's absolutely fine. We've got a lot of questions to get through this morning, so I would just ask everyone to keep questions, answers and any follow-ups quite tight, please. Colleagues in the room should indicate to myself or the clerk if they wish to come in and ask a supplementary, and committee members online should use the chat box or the WhatsApp. So we will move straight to questions from members, and our first theme will be covered by Pam Duncan-Glancy. Thank you.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for engaging with the committee on this so far. I just have a couple of questions about the consultation that's led to the review and the proposals that we have before us today. And probably maybe to start with Martin, if that's all right. What is your view of the consultation to date, the previous one that was done in 2019 and again repeated? What's your view of that? And do you think there are any areas of regulation that haven't yet been covered as part of the review and the bill that we see before us?
From our point of view, the consultation has been satisfactory. You know, there have been two consultations. I think the second one gave an opportunity to drill down a little bit further into some of the issues that come up in the first one. From our point of view, we have been able to fully engage with Scottish Government on the proposals. Indeed, they first came from us as part of our statutory function of advising ministers. So it's been satisfactory from our point of view. Again, from our point of view, the bill covers the areas that we have indicated need to be updated, given the age of the underlying legislation. So we're quite satisfied with the coverage. The only thing that isn't there that we had suggested would be there is the power for reorganisation of bodies established by statute. But we understand that there are complexities around that, and discussions are ongoing about that.
Okay, thank you for that. Do you think there's a need for a wider review?
We would entirely welcome a wider review. And we would be very happy, and we would be intending to be fully involved and to inform that review. I don't think it's for us to necessarily set limitations or say what that should be, that should cover, but we would welcome it.
A number of organisations said to us last week the importance of that being an independent review. What would your view of that be?
I don't think we would have any particular view on that. We would be happy to engage with whatever format came out there.
And do you have any understanding as to why some of the other regulatory frameworks that charities are required to respond to weren't included in this particular legislation?
Are you meaning other regulators that regulate charities?
So last week we heard particularly from, I think, the Children's Hospice Association, and in fact SAVO as well, that there are a number of different requirements on charities from various different regulators. Yeah. So it's just a bit of an understanding of your view of that.
Yeah, I mean, we work with a lot of other regulators that have dual or overlapping regulation of the charities that we regulate, the Care Inspectorate, Scottish Housing Regulator and other bodies. We have memorandum of understanding, we have the power to share information with them, and we work quite hard to try and minimise dual regulation and overlap and minimise the burden on charities. So that's how we work now. And clearly if there is a sort of sense there that needs to be looked at, well, we'd be happy to engage with that.
Thank you. Alan, I wonder if I could come to you with the same question around the review, and in particular, is there any aspect of regulation that you think is missing from the proposals?
Well, thank you. The Society has welcomed the review and the opportunity to engage in the consultation process throughout. Indeed, there was one item in the bill that wasn't in the original consultation, which was a proposal coming from the Society, which has made its way into the bill. So certainly we have welcomed that opportunity to engage, and there's an example of where that engagement from the Society's point of view has led to something coming into the bill. Yes, there are areas where we think there is further reform that would be useful in the Society's original response to the consultation. We set out a sort of detailed analysis of the 2005 Act, where we thought there were technical amendments and improvements that could be made. There are certainly some that we would have liked to have seen in the bill. Martin gave the example of charities that are established by Act of Parliament or other enactment. I think it would be an improvement to enable those to go through the OSCAR reorganisation process, particularly now that we have OSCAR having been in place for 15-plus years and the experience they've built up. So we would have thought it would make sense for those charities to be able to go to OSCAR rather than having the expense and time of going through a parliamentary process. And whilst they are very interesting cases to be involved in from a legal point of view, the OSCAR process would be more streamlined, we would have thought, and therefore better for the charity and better for the charity delivering its services. Another area that we think would be good to see in this bill, without major further work being done, we think, is around the process for unincorporated charities becoming incorporated charities, often Scottish charitable incorporated organisations. Usually that's for better governance. Sometimes it's funders requiring that change, sometimes public funding requiring that change to be incorporated, and that process as it stands is not that simple, and we think that would be one area where there is an opportunity to improve things, and perhaps in this bill.
And do you think the proposal in front of us would need amended to take account of that?
The bill as introduced would not deal with those particular two points that I mentioned there around charities looking to reorganise if they're set up by Act of Parliament, or for unincorporated charities, so that's trusts, unincorporated associations, looking to move into perhaps a better governance framework, particularly the Scottish Charitable Incorporated Organisation.
Thank you. Appreciate that, Alan. Can I ask John, are there any areas within the proposed legislation that you think will link well with the other parts of the United Kingdom or the charities regulation there? What's your experience been of implementing similar proposals?
Well, I suppose taking the two questions separately, I think the two regimes operate quite independently. There's not a great deal of overlap or dual regulation between England and Wales and Scotland. Mm-hmm. So in a technical sense and in an operational sense, the two regimes don't need to overlap so much. I think where there is interoperability, like in automatic disqualification, I think the bill is helpful because it seeks to align the automatic disqualification criteria between the two sides of the border. So if a trustee is disqualified automatically under the law of England and Wales, then the same is true in Scotland and vice versa. So that's helpful in that regard. But beyond that, I don't think that's particularly necessary. I think in terms of how the two regimes operate more broadly and how the bill is amending or seeking to amend the Scottish regime, I think we have to look at them quite separately. I don't think there's an inherent need for one to match the other, and I think there's historical reasons why the two regimes have developed separately. So I think that's, I'm neutral on the point, I guess.
And is there anything in particular you can share with the committee about your experience as a regulator and the charity's experience in England and Wales of some of these changes, like the auto-disqualification? And I know that members will come to questions on that later, but is there anything we could learn from the process and how you supported charities to meet the new obligations?
Certainly. I think, although it's quite a general statement, I think early and clear communication with the sector is important. I think when developing guidance on changes to legislation, there's quite an art to that. The Charity Commission England and Wales is going through a major process at the moment to implement the Charities Act 2022, which is delivering a number of technical reforms to our legislation. And it's not to be underestimated the challenge of trying to accurately and accessibly communicate the nature of the changes to the entire sector, which of course is very diverse between large and small charities, complex and simple charities, lots of different perspectives and lots of different ranges of experience. So that's something that I would lean on, and certainly, you know, to the extent that colleagues at OSCA would like to be speaking to us, then we have open channels of communication to talk about how these things are implemented.
Did that affect the resources that you had available? Did you need more resources to be able to communicate that to charities?
We didn't seek or get more resources for that, but we have prioritised that over other things we might have done with the same time and cost, certainly.
Okay, thank you. And just ending on that point with a final question, I guess, to Martin then. The last week, Volunteer Scotland said that they will not know the true impact of the legislation on charities and their trustees until it's clear how OSCA intend to communicate and implement the new measures. This is not clarified with the detail in the bill, and SCBO said the administration and comms budget could be significant, and notwithstanding the point that we've heard from John, who I think from what he said is there's been a bit of reprioritisation. How are you preparing for this legislation? What are your plans to communicate with the third sector on it? And do you think you will be able to do it within existing budgets?
Okay, I mean, you're taking the first question first.
Sorry, I don't mean to interrupt. Can I just, those questions are for, they come under theme three, so they will be covered in another theme. If you have any supplementaries to those questions, Pam, I'm more than happy to bring you in then, but I'd just like to keep it in line with where we're going.
Okay, I think we have a different understanding of the thematic organisation of it, but that's absolutely fine. We can get answers to those questions later if you wish.
That would be great, thank you. Thank you all. If we could now move on to questions from Paul McLennan on theme two, which is general principles of the bill.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, panel. Just talking about the general principles of the bill, and I suppose this is just a question for yourself in terms of, Martin, in terms of OSCA, do the provisions in the bill accurately reflect the proposals you put forward in your paper in 2018? And I suppose just looking beyond that as well, as do they support your regulatory role and how effective that is at the moment? And obviously then talking around about the extensions, do you think they're appropriate and proportionate? And obviously I'll open it up to the rest of the panel, but just on that yourself.
So yes, simply yes, they do reflect the proposals. And thinking back to why we made those proposals, the original legislation dates back to 2005. We have, you know, obviously quite a few years of experience with regulating the sector now. And the proposals we made very much reflected our experience of that. I suppose also a sense of what had changed in the sector, but I think also what had changed more generally. If you think you were back in 2005, that probably wasn't the same, and when the 2005 Act was drafted, there wasn't the same sense of possibility in terms of what you could do with publishing information online and making it transparent in that way. And I think some of what's in the Act at the moment, the 2005 Act at the moment, reflects a sort of older perception of that. So the idea that you could put all charity accounts online, you know, fairly easily, wasn't there. I think we need to reflect the fact that there are opportunities to do that, and to you know, take all the opportunities we can to increase the transparency of charities to and their activities, and the transparency of regulation as well, to increase public trust and confidence in charities.
Just on that one, because again, obviously, we had a few evidence sessions. We had an informal evidence session with charities as well, and one of the great things we talked about was obviously transparency and accountability in terms of that. And I think it was broadly welcomed, but I don't know if you've had any feedback and any thoughts in terms of that, but you've heard from charities and so on, but it certainly was something that they welcomed.
Yeah, and I think from the surveys we do and also from our day-to-day contact with charities, I think most charities absolutely accept and welcome transparency. A lot of your charities nowadays are very proactive themselves in putting information out, putting their constitutions, their accounts online, and you know, being open about what they do. Partly that's helpful in terms of attracting funding and maintaining trust. So I think charities, certainly accept it in principle. You know, sometimes that's more difficult for some charities than others in terms of the practice of it.
For example.
Yeah. And we do understand that we are required in terms of the 2005 Act to act proportionally and to be targeted in terms of the action that we take, and that is something that we think about all the time. It's something that we will very much bear in mind in terms of the implementation of this bill, as we do with what else we do.
Good. Well, thanks for that, Alan. John, I don't know if you want to comment on about Oscar, and obviously then the accountability and transparency issue that was obviously really important in driving this forward.
I mean, I think from the society's point of view, we think that the general principles and that idea that this is a package that's aimed at transparency and accountability is a fair and proper one, and it's for us building on the 2005 Act, because it was very new, in a very broad brush way. Prior to that, there wasn't really Scottish charity law in a sort of proactive a way. So this is an opportunity to build on it with that experience of a number of years of having a proper regulatory regime in Scotland. And we do think that it does strike the balance. Yes, there will be issues perhaps around the publication of names where people have raised some issues, but on the whole, we think that is something that is going to be workable, does strike the right balance. And when we compare it to other systems, Companies House, of which many charities are companies, or what the Charity Commission produces and what charities themselves need to capture in terms of who their trustees are, etc., we don't see that as being a significant burden or a significant new burden for charities to deal with.
Thanks, John.
Just briefly, I think it's not really our place to comment on the sort of value judgments as to the effectiveness of the legislation or the proposals, but I think we would certainly say that transparency and accountability are very important principles. It's a principle which the Commission pursues in England and Wales. Indeed, it's one of our statutory objectives to enhance accountability. And actually, what we can see in terms of the direction of travel in policy is the same sort of direction of travel that the English and Welsh legislation has followed in terms of, firstly, enhancing transparency and accountability, and also providing the regulator with more graduated and more refined powers in order to enforce compliance where necessary.
Okay, John, thank you. That's very helpful. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Paul. Now move on to theme 3 regarding information about charity trustees, and move over to Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, panel. Good to see you here. My first question is to Martin. Can Oscar give some insight into how the register may operate from a public perspective? And is there an expectation that it's going to be fully digitised?
Yeah, absolutely. So the Scottish Charity Register at the moment it's a fully online register, and you just log, get onto our website, and the first thing that comes up on our website is a register search, and you can search by the name of the charity keywords or the charity number, and the entry for the charity will come up. When we, if the bill is passed and we collect charity trustee information, charity trustee names and only the names will come up on as a result of a search on a charity. So you'll get the entry for the charity and the trustee names will come up as part of that entry. It won't be searchable by trustee name. It's only searchable as part of the charity's information.
Thanks, Martin. There are some concerns that we've seen in evidence about digital exclusion. What would you say to that?
I mean, we, as I say, we have a fully online register. A huge majority of charities, almost all charities, communicate with us online now through our OSCAR online system. They give us an annual return every year, and that is almost entirely completed online. We do accommodate where charities are unable to do that, and we would do so with the current proposals in terms of supplying us with trustee details, but it would be primarily online.
Okay, thank you. And if I could move on to John for this question. And can the Charity Commission give any comment as to how such a register operates in England and Wales?
Certainly. So you may be aware that we display all names of charity trustees on our public register as part of the record of each registered charity. That's subject to a dispensation policy in relation to physical security, where OSCAR is going to have similar provisions in place in terms of its public register. I think we do see it as central to, again, transparency and accountability of charities and charity trustees. And it's something which I don't think within our framework and within our sector is any matter of difficulty at all. I don't think there's any concern about it. It's not something we are told is contentious in any way. It's simply a part of the process, much like registering a company and having company directors' details published. It's a key part of what we publish.
Okay, and just one final question for me, because I know Pam might want to come in with her question. Do you have any concerns generally about the proposals for OSCAR to gather and maintain up-to-date information on charity trustees and to include the names of trustees, because again we've heard from some that this is a worry? And whoever would like to come in.
Right. So from society's point of view, these provisions we don't see as overly burdensome for charities, and in many ways it will come down to these operational matters in terms of how it works in practice, and as John was mentioning there about what happens in England and what is proposed for Scotland, there will be provisions where if there are names and details that shouldn't be made public, that will be possible to take that out of the system.
And I would just comment, as John said, there is a process where charities can or individuals can ask to be dispensed from having their name published. That's similar to provisions that we currently have for information to be excluded from the register for certain charities, whether there are issues of security to people or places. I think part of the communication that we would do in the run-up to implementation with charities is to make sure that people are aware of that, are aware of how that works. And I think maybe do some targeted work with some of the charities where we know that that's an issue. Women's Aid charities, for instance.
Okay. Thank you for that.
Thanks very much, Evelyn. And we'll move to Pam Duncan-Glancy for a supplementary.
Thank you, Convener, and apologies for the preview earlier of this question. I'll repeat it again because I know we've moved on slightly. Volunteer Scotland said to us last week that we will not know the true impact of the legislation on charities and their trustees until it's clear how OSCAR intend to communicate and implement new measures. This is not clarified within the detail of the bill. And SEVO said admin and comms budget may be significant. So can I ask Martin, how are you preparing for this? Do you think you will be able to do it within existing budgets, and how will you communicate this?
So I think one general point, a lot of the measures in the bill are expansions or augmentations of things that we already do or things that charities and charity trustees are already used to. For instance, putting in an annual return or being able to ask for information to be excluded from the register. So we're not starting from a zero base there. But we absolutely recognise that a big part of the implementation for us will be communications. And we're thinking very hard about a communications campaign, the communications strategy there. That will depend on commencement dates and how that's phased and when things, particular things, come in. But what we will be doing there is a phase running up to implementation of specific measures, generally with the sector, to look at what it means for charity trustees generally. We will do specific targeted communications where we think there may be particular factors or particular issues with particular subsectors, and making sure that they know what will be involved there, and making sure that we know from them what they think the issues might be, in detail. There'll be quite intensive communications during the implementation, and that we have a lot of channels to communicate with charity trustees at the moment that people are used to, that people are used to referring to. We have the ability to connect directly with charities, and we will use those. And then after the implementation, there will be a sort of phase there where people will need support. And we will be looking at what we need for the ongoing support for specific provisions and implementation of specific provisions.
And in the development of how you will do that, what kind of engagement will you do with smaller charities?
We will be looking to work in a very targeted way with smaller charities. We work a lot, for instance, with the likes of Gilguide in Scotland, Scout Scotland. A lot of the smaller charities that we have will fall into those kind of generic categories. Also with churches, with the designated religious charities, and with the umbrella bodies, the likes of the third sector interfaces in the local council areas. As with a lot of the engagement and sector improvement work we do, a lot of the most effective way to do it is through other people. We aren't the sole purveyors of wisdom here. People like Gilguide Scotland, Early Years Scotland, they know their sectors, they know what the issues are likely to be, and how best to help people implement and get used to specific measures in their sector. And we need to take cognizance of that and take advantage of that.
Okay, that's helpful. So you'll commit to working with those organisations to look at the communication and implementation?
Absolutely. We do already, and that would be really sort of part and parcel of what we'd be wanting to do here.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Pam. We'll now move to questions from Faisal Chowdhury, who is joining us online.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, panel. Before I ask the question, I would like to declare an interest as a chair of a charity organisation. And Convener, my apologies, I should have done that before. The question I think I'll probably direct to Martin, if any witnesses want to get involved. Do the witnesses have any concern that this would disproportionately affect smaller charities, particularly ethnic minority charities that are already struggling to stay in business given the cost of living crisis?
Who would you like to direct that to, Faisal?
Martin?
I think our view is that we need to make sure that in the implementation we thoroughly bear in mind the need to be proportionate in the way that we implement this. And in my previous answer, I think a lot of this will be around working with the umbrella bodies, and that there are some umbrella bodies specifically for ethnic minority charities, working with them to identify where there are specific issues or specific factors that might make it more difficult to implement specific provisions here. But that you know, we want to be targeted, and we want to be proactive, and to do a lot of that up front, rather than waiting for issues to appear.
Thank you. Sorry.
Yeah. Carry on, Faisal.
Yeah, sure. Do you have any concerns regarding the provisions for charities to deduct certain information from published accounts where there might be safety or security concerns? I mean, and that's probably a question for Alan.
Well, I think the, as I said previously, in terms of the new rules about publishing names, etc., and providing that kind of information, we don't see that being overly burdensome or causing significant problems to charities. And there are those protections where there is sensitive information or reasons to not have that information being made public. Maybe just going back one moment onto smaller charities, we wouldn't see the bill causing significant issues for smaller charities in terms of what is in the bill. We think smaller charities could be helped by having some of the topics that we have thought would be additional points for a bill, particularly around unincorporated charities converting into SCIOs, and even the provisions for charities established by Act of Parliament sometimes affect very small charities. The way in which some charities have become established by Act of Parliament is quite unusual. There was times in the past where it was en vogue for people who have left assets to charities under their will for that then to be turned into an Act of Parliament. So you have a small charity magically being governed by an Act of Parliament. So I think there are provisions that are not in the bill that could help smaller charities and use their funds in a better, more effective way for their charitable purposes.
Thank you. My last question, convener, probably to John. I mean, I've been involved in smaller organisations, and majority of the trustees are volunteers, and they're working elsewhere. Is there any sort of support will be provided, to the smaller organisations if they're struggling? What kind of supports can be provided?
Well, if you're thinking about support in terms of dealing with the shift to the implementation of new legislation, I think the support which we provide to charities in our jurisdiction is mostly in the form of guidance and outreach activities through explaining the provisions, and we work quite hard to ensure that our guidance is accessible. We're very aware that the majority of trustees are volunteers. They're working in their spare time, and most charities don't have the resources to pay for professional advice on new legislation and the like. So we are very conscious of that. We're very aware of that, and we also rely on sector bodies and the like to be knowledge hubs in relation to the changes. But I suspect from my experience that the sorts of changes that are going through in this bill are not changes which would impose enormous administrative burdens on charities, because some of this stuff is particularly around the register of trustee names. It's information which charities are going to hold already, and it should, I would imagine, be a fairly simple filing requirement. So I don't think there should be too much concern in that regard.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much, Faisal. Just on this theme, do any of the witnesses have any concerns around the proposal to publish unredacted accounts for all charities? Regardless of size, we heard last week and within witnesses from some of the witnesses that they suggested a threshold could be implemented so that charities with smaller incomes would be exempt. Would the witnesses support such a measure? I'll maybe go to Alan first.
I mean, certainly the idea of information being made available is, you know, something the society would support in terms of the general principles of the bill. And again, as long as there's not information in there that would be causing you know, any risks to anyone, then we would see the provision of information being a good thing. And from the public's reassurance, the ability to get easy access to information about charities is something that we would think would support the sector, support people you know, fundraising and getting involved with the sector, rather than being a hindrance. But as I say, you know, making sure that there are protections around certain pieces of information.
Would you agree then that removing the charitable status from organisations that fail to submit accounts is an appropriate measure?
Yes, if a charity is not doing that, you know, key fundamental basic thing, then you know, having provisions that allow OSCR to more easily deal with that situation, we would support.
Okay, Martin.
Yeah, I mean, just on a sort of point of clarification there, what's proposed isn't to give us the power to remove simply because a charity fails to submit its accounts. They have to both fail to submit and not engage with us. So there is a safeguard there, and you know, where your charities are generally genuinely struggling for whatever reason, as some did during the pandemic, for instance, to get accounts finalised, you know, we can have that dialogue with them, and that won't result in removal.
Okay, so my next question then was going to be around the routes to appeal. What routes to appeal will be in place for charities who fail to publish their accounts on time? Obviously, you've talked about that communication. Yeah. Could you maybe expand on that?
Yeah, I mean, so there are quite a lot of, what would you call it, hurdles for us to go over before we remove a charity. So, you know, we would have to have a pattern of attempts to engage with the charity. We would need to publish the fact that we were going to remove it for a time to allow the charity to come back and sort of say, wait a minute, you can't do that. We'll have our accounts by Tuesday. If we do remove, then decision can be subject to the statutory review procedure that's in the Act. If they don't like the result of that review, which is carried out internally by us, then there is an appeal to the Charities Tribunal.
Okay, thank you, Martin. And just last question from myself, and again back to you, Martin. Can you go into any further detail as to the criteria for what constitutes a safety or a security concern, and how would a review of OSCR decisions work in practice?
So, this is something, again, it is something that's a factor in the law and in our practice at the moment. So where charities are asking to be registered, they can say, we don't want our address to be published on the register. So this is a bit of decision making that we do at the moment. And looking at the wording of the Act and it's replicated in the bill, we would be looking to see evidence that there was a sort of specific and clear reason why publishing the information would jeopardise the safety and security of individuals or of the premises. Again, the example is you know, Women's Aid, Women's Refuges, where, you know, that would make individual people vulnerable. I think that's very clear to us. I think there are something like 69 charities on the register at the moment who have information excluded on that basis. Where we excluded that information, then the charity would be able to exclude information from their accounts.
Okay, that's very helpful, thank you. Okay, we'll move on now to Emma Roddick, Deputy Convener Emma Roddick, who is joining us online.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. My first question is also for you, Martin, and I know that the Law Society did address this in its response, but I'd be keen to hear from you around whether you think it is sensible to have the same disqualification criteria in place across the UK, and if there are any areas where Scotland could go further.
We do very strongly think it's sensible to have the same disqualification criteria across the UK. If you look at the criteria, the new ones that the bill is coming in, those are for matters which I think any member of the public would think are serious ones, and where I think pretty much everyone would regard that as matters that would prevent someone from properly acting as a charity trustee. At the moment, theoretically, someone could act here as a charity trustee when they couldn't in England and Wales, where you know they had been found to have done something really serious. So I think in terms of public trust and confidence, we do think that's right. I don't think we would have any desire at present to go beyond what's in England and Wales.
Okay, and in terms of the proposal then to extend the disqualification criteria to senior management positions as well, do you agree with that, and do you anticipate it having any implications on recruitment?
We do agree with that. Again, there is a issue of public trust and confidence. You know, given the kind of decision making that the charity trustees sometimes delegate to senior members of staff, you know, in terms of the operation and decision making in a charity, where people are, you know, would be disqualified if they were a charity trustee, we think there is a need to guard against that sort of vulnerability there, and to meet what would be legitimate public expectations there and maintain confidence there. In terms of recruitment, I think a lot of what is in the disqualifications are things that would probably be part of the due diligence that most employers would do for new recruits anyway. In terms of the numbers involved, I'm not sure we do see that it would have a big impact on recruitment.
Okay, thank you. And finally, to yourself, I do have questions for other witnesses too. Do you think it is appropriate for Oscar to maintain a publicly searchable record of trustees and does have been disqualified, and does it present any issues around handling sensitive personal data?
So I suppose it's quite good maybe to start from the reason for this. At the moment, it is quite hard for charity trustees who are recruiting new charity trustees to do their due diligence in respect of people who the regulator has decided can't be charity trustees. There's a gap there in the due diligence that charity trustees are able to do, and that's what this measure tries to address. In terms of information and data issues around this, clearly we would be very keen to guard against any sense that the wrong people were being identified from a register search. So the register will set out enough detail reflecting the original court decision to disqualify the person, enough personal details to distinguish them. But what we will be saying is that if there is any uncertainty there, then charity trustees should contact us to try and just make sure of who they're dealing with.
Okay, thank you very much. If I can move on then to Alan, because I've read the submission, obviously, but what are your thoughts on the comments that have been made by previous witnesses to the committee that measures for disqualification are too punitive and restrictive on those wishing to act as trustees?
We would take the view that the extension of the disqualification rules does seem a sensible one. That's one area where alignment with neighbouring jurisdictions would appear to make sense, and the idea that it now extends to senior management we would see as one that is reasonable, and again is maybe an example of where we're building on the 2005 Act based on the experience of 15 plus years of seeing what happens, and the idea that those who have very important roles within charities are subject to this regime, you know, we wouldn't think would be much of a surprise to the public, and probably would give them some further reassurance about how charities are being operated.
Okay, and are there any concerns that the disqualification criteria might disproportionately impact certain demographics and not others, and particularly when thinking about charities that do work within those demographics and might be looking for lived experience?
I mean, I think what is important in an issue like that, but also generally with how the regulatory system works here, is that OSCAR is statutorily required to be a proportionate regulator, and certainly in my experience is a proportionate and reasonable regulator to be dealing with, and therefore will deal with matters properly, and I don't see that it's going to affect particular groups in different ways, and there are the there should be a proper system for dealing with any issues that arise, including something as serious as someone being potentially disqualified as a trustee.
Thanks, Emma. Sorry, Emma, just before you go on, I think, Martin, had you wanted to come in on this?
Yes, I just thought it might be helpful. I think some of the sort of previous discussion around this has concentrated on people being disqualified from acting as a trustee by reason of personal bankruptcy. That is an existing disqualification criterion, has been since 2005. It's not a new thing that the bill is bringing in. And I suppose that the anxieties here come in because of the current situation, the cost of living crisis and the pressures on people. I suppose what I would say there is that bankruptcy or having a protected trust deed tends to be a relatively short-term thing. I think the average personal bankruptcy will last 12 months, and then you are free to act as a charity trustee. So it's probably a lot more temporary than the other disqualifications.
Thanks, Martin.
Sorry,
Emma, if you have further questions, on you go.
Yeah, I do have a few. Sorry, convener. But the point made by Martin just there was important, I think, because we did note that a lot of witnesses seem to believe that bankruptcy was not an existing disqualification. Do you think there is an issue with awareness or maybe implementation of that at the moment that's causing this discrepancy?
I wonder if there might be, and I think that's something we're reflecting on in terms of our communication, and indeed the sort of communication around the implementation of this bill probably gives us an opportunity to do a little bit of a reset and communicate very clearly about how things are at the moment.
I think maybe
thank you.
I was just going to add, if okay, that maybe that's true, that what and certainly rather than a society point of view, just from some cases in which I've had to give advice on this point, maybe it is people thinking that if you have been bankrupt, then that affects your ability to do that forever, rather than covering the period in which the bankruptcy arrangements are in place. And certainly I have had that question asked of me, and the relatively speedy answer and the one that gives reassurance both to individuals and charities there is that it is not something that applies after the bankruptcy arrangements have been completed.
Thank you. And just finally here, if I can go to John. As the Charity Commission for England and Wales, are you able to offer insight into how disqualification criteria and process there works at the moment and how it aligns with Scotland, and specifically how your register of disqualified individuals operates?
Certainly. So I guess there's two separate things. There's our power of discretionary disqualification, which is not something that's being proposed to be introduced here. And that's what our proactively maintained register relates to, is people who've been actively disqualified. I believe in Scotland the equivalent power would be for the court rather than for the regulator. And then separately there's automatic disqualification. We maintain a register of people who've been disqualified by order, but we we work on automatic disqualification through advice and guidance to trustees, through searches of other public registers like the Insolvency Register, the Register of Disqualified Company Directors, because there's a crossover there in terms of when you're subject to one of those provisions, in the same terms as the Scotland Bill, effectively, when you're subject to one of those provisions, you're then automatically disqualified. I think if I can reflect on the introduction of the current list of automatic disqualification criteria, which came in England and Wales in an Act passed in 2016, I think there was probably there was some concern at the time about the scope and scale of how far automatic disqualification was going to go, and I think the post-implementation review that was carried out by the Westminster Government, the Department for Culture, Media and Sport, showed that the concern about the burden placed on the sector was not borne out by the impact in practice, which I think might be helpful. I suppose the one other thing to say is we do embed the automatic disqualification criteria in things like our trustee declaration that we require people to complete on registration, and then in our guidance for trustees around appointing new trustees, we advise people to work through that in terms of doing their own due diligence.
Thanks, Emma. We have some supplementaries on that line of questioning. Pat, first from Pam, thank you.
Thank you, convener. Just a couple that have arisen from, particularly from the answers given. Can I start, John, the point that you made around the discretionary qualification versus the automatic? Can you explain that a bit and what we would need to do here to apply a discretionary qualification instead of an automatic qualification?
I defer to Martin around conversations that have happened in the development of the bill. Discretionary disqualification is something that's outside of scope of what this bill relates to, I believe. It's currently a power in Scotland for the Court of Session to remove trustees. The England and Wales Charity Commission has a power of discretionary disqualification in cases of misconduct and mismanagement or need to protect charitable resources. But it's a separate part of our framework, if you like. Automatic disqualification happens by operation of law. So if a certain circumstance applies to you, such as bankruptcy, for example, then you simply are disqualified by the provisions of our Act, and that's what the current Scotland Bill proposes to introduce here.
Thank you. Martin, is there a reason why a discretionary qualification approach couldn't be used in Scotland? And the reason I'm asking is because of some of the lines of questioning that my colleague Emma Roddick has suggested, which is some organisations have said it could be a little punitive to automatically disqualify people. And I take the point about public interest. I do take that point. But a lot of charities are people who want to become trustees in charities, maybe doing so to rebuild their life, and they may have some convictions for which they will now be automatically disqualified. So Is there scope potentially for it to be discretionary, or how would you address that?
I think the first thing I'd say is disqualifications on automatic disqualification on grounds of bankruptcy or on grounds of having an unspent conviction for dishonesty. Those are in the 2005 Act. They have been operating for the last 17 years. Those are sort of very, if you like, very close to the spine of charity trustee duties. For instance, with the disqualification on grounds of bankruptcy, if you're bankrupt, if you have a protected trust deed, that takes away your ability to control your own affairs. Now, charity trustee duties, you're acting on the standard of care that you have to exercise is the standard of care you would exercise in looking after the affairs of another person. There's something very problematic about doing that if you are not able fully to look after your own affairs. It's you're getting into something that's quite fundamental there. So I don't think there would be the scope in the current bill, and we wouldn't necessarily support it. I think the other thing I would say, and on that point you make about people wanting to rebuild their lives, simply because you're disqualified as a charity trustee, it doesn't stop you volunteering for a charity. It doesn't necessarily stop you working for a charity. In the new bill, If you were a senior member of staff, it might disqualify you. But if you're not, it wouldn't stop you necessarily working for a charity, provided the charity trustees were happy.
Okay, and what kind of process do you imagine would be in place for wavering that or for challenging that decision?
Yeah, I mean, again, this is something that is there in the current legislation. It's a process that we currently operate. What we would do there is that we would look at waiver applications. What we would concentrate on is where the request to waive a disqualification for an individual reflects the purposes and the activities of a particular charity. Is there something about the skill or the experience, for instance, the sort of life experience of a particular person that means it's necessary for them to be a charity trustee? It's a job that really only them or someone like them can do. So we'll be looking from the point of view of the needs of the charity primarily, and also how the charity would manage any risks from that.
And the administrative burden on proof for that, would that be, where would the kind of level
well,
be?
It is for the person and, you know, to an extent that the other charity trustees to make a case for that. You know, that there is an, you know, it's an exception. Automatic disqualification means just that. So, you know, it is effectively requesting us to make an exception, and they would need to make a case as to why that exception should be applied.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
Thank you, Pam. And another supplementary from Paul McLennan.
Pam's kind of almost touching it, because one of the issues that kind of came up, Martin, in the informal sessions we had was about, for example, rehabilitation of prisoners who are obviously have that experience in coming through. And I think that example you gave would probably be one you probably consider that approach, because that was raised by a couple of charities who deal with rehabilitation, and obviously their lived experience is extremely vital. And that, so would that be the kind of example you would look at?
It would be. I mean, you know, if you were talking about someone there who had an unspent conviction for dishonesty, and the trustees were you know, putting forward a case that looked, you know, this person, by reason of their lived experience, you know, we think they are uniquely fitted to be a trustee of this charity. That would depend on its purpose, depend on what it did. Then we would look at that really seriously. But we would also say, well, okay, what is this person doing? How will the rest of you exercise your duties in respect of how they go on with their duties?
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Paul. And just one final point on that. So the bill would give Oscar the power to create a database of people, obviously, who have been removed from being involved in the administration of a charity by the courts. The consequences for individuals who are mistakenly thought to be in this position could be really significant. For example, they might not be able to work within the charity sector. Can Oscar explain how the risk of mistaken identity will be minimised in relation to public searches of the database?
The process here, the person will have already gone through a court process, and the register will very fully reflect their identity and the details of that process, and you know, we will be looking very hard to make sure that there is sufficient information there to enable people to be distinguished, you know, easily. But what we'll also be saying at the side of that is, if you know, charity trustees have have concerns, have doubts, they'll be invited to get in touch with us, so that it can be verified.
Thank you, Martin. Do any of the other panelists have any ideas on how that should be approached? Alan, I saw you making eye contact during that.
No, nothing further from me on that one.
Okay, perfect. Okay, we will move on then to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I wanted to ask some specific questions with regards to how this will impact on the numbers of charities in Scotland. Specifically, do you think this will result in fewer charities if the bill goes through Parliament? Martin, I'll maybe bring yourself in.
I suspect that it will. I think the particularly the power to remove charities where they've not submitted accounts to us and where they're not engaging with us, I think that what that will do will be enable us to remove some charities from the register where effectively, I think possibly as a result of the pandemic and the kind of cessation of activity in a lot of charities through the pandemic, trustees have kind of just walked away. You know, the thing's just kind of fallen down and trustees have walked away. They haven't wound it up formally. And it'll enable us to take out a sort of bulge of charities that are sitting on the register like that that we don't currently have an ability to deal with. So it will, I think, adjust it downwards a bit.
And have you done any work to sort of quantify what that looks like? How many we're talking about?
It's a little bit of a sort of known unknown. We have quite a high level of non-submission of accounts at the moment. Much higher than it has been historically, and again, we think that's a result of the pandemic. It's about 11% of charities at the moment have failed to submit accounts on time. That's a bit higher than the historic level. And we think a proportion of that kind of additional number there will be charities that are in this situation, but it's very hard to quantify because they're not engaging. It's much easier where you're dealing with charities that are engaging but are just having problems with submission.
Yep, thank you for that. And I wondered, has any research been undertaken into organisations in Scotland who, if they're not currently registered as a charity in Scotland, what impact that will have in them accessing funds, and whether or not that might result in more people then thinking they should register in Scotland under the new bill?
I think that there's been quite a lot of thinking over the past few years about community bodies, about social enterprises. Some social enterprises are charities, some charities undertake social enterprise activities, and then you have social enterprises that are a bit more towards the kind of trading end of things, who would never want to be charities. But I think that there is a degree of interest and fluidity about the sort of boundaries between those categories and charity. So I mean, it's interesting what some of the things that sort of drive people to seek organisations to seek charitable status. Alan's already alluded to some of them. It will be about funding. It will be about the tax or the local taxation advantages, and where those things change, that's where we see fluctuations in the number of registration applications we get. For instance, there was a tax change affecting community sports clubs back in the 20-teens. That made it more advantageous to be a charity, and we got a lot of applications from the likes of bowling and tennis clubs.
Yeah, thank you for that. And that was one of the points I think we have had concerns around smaller charities, sometimes village hall charities, things like that, and the pressure which is on them, sometimes individuals, to submit accounts. And I just wondered specifically the proposal around unredacted accounts for all charities, regardless of size, being published, whether or not you thought there was need for some flexibility in that around income, potentially.
I suppose that the going back to first principles here, I think what everyone would expect of a charity is to prepare accounts. To keep looking at what the trustee duties are. Everyone would expect charity trustees to be able to keep control and keep a sense of their charity's financial situation. So I think preparing accounts is almost a given. The requirement to submit accounts to us is a long-standing one. And obviously, I say there's been a dip in compliance with that, but historically, the levels have been pretty high of compliance with that. So I'm not sure that the publication of accounts adds to the burden or necessarily becomes more burdensome. I suppose the point I'd also make there, our regulatory experience is that people really care about small charities. People care about what's happening in their village hall. A lack of clarity there, a lack of trust there, that can have surprisingly big consequences in small communities.
Thank you. And do you think, in terms of removing charitable status from organisations that have failed to submit their accounts, is an appropriate measure? Is that, you know, a very last resort in what you've outlined in terms of trying to work with them to get that information?
Absolutely. It is a last resort. And as I said before, we won't be able to remove simply because they fail to submit. It'll be because they fail to engage as well. If they're engaging, well, yes, we can work with them. If they're not engaging, we can't.
Yeah. Does anyone else have anything they want to add on any of those questions?
I mean, I suppose on this, will it affect the number of charities? We don't see the bill leading to less people wanting to be setting up charities because of what's in the bill. The register of mergers to do with legacies might see a very small number of charities who probably shouldn't be there, or not shouldn't be, but don't need to be there, coming off the register. What the bill doesn't do, and we think could usefully do, is in terms of the right types of charities. There are smaller, unincorporated charities who probably would want to be and should be incorporated, and the bill doesn't help them. And you mentioned something like a village hall. If you've got a smaller charity which might be asset heavy, the process of moving to a better governance structure, one that actually encourages new trustees to come on board, which is sometimes the reason why they want to become incorporated, that process is quite difficult, and the bill doesn't take that opportunity to smooth that process for them.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thank you, Miles. Can I just ask, before moving on to my colleague, do you think it's appropriate for Oscar to be able to issue positive directions following inquiry work? And is it appropriate for designated religious charities to be exempt from this provision? I'll go to Martin first, thank you.
We do think it's appropriate. This is one that very much comes from our regulatory experience. Power for us to issue positive directions would be a very circumscribed one. There are hurdles that we have to get through. We have to show that there's misconduct in the administration of the charity, or that there are assets that need to be protected. That could only come as a result of an inquiry on our part and considerable engagement with the charity. But there are situations where we do need to make, I think, very specific, very sort of measured, very timed directions to get charity trustees, usually to do something that falls within their duties or what their constitution says they have to do, and they're not doing it.
Okay, thank you. Would anyone else like to come in on that? No, don't feel obliged.
John. The thing in Wales, it's a power that we've got. It's a power that we use quite regularly, and it's effectively part of a toolkit of powers. I think when we use this power more often, it might be in a slightly different context, because our power of positive direction is often used to issue things like action plans and plans for improved governance in relation to a charity, and the effect of issuing that by order makes it a legal obligation which can then be enforced using our other powers. So it's part of a sort of suite of compliance powers that we've got, and it's one that we use quite regularly.
Thank you, John. And just a kind of supplementary to that, Martin, I'll back to you again, sorry. Can you outline the procedures in place where a smaller charity, which is overseen by a larger organisation, is under investigation? So what level of engagement does the parent charity currently have in this process? And does it present any challenges?
So, unless the parent charity is a designated religious charity, there isn't a sort of formal provision for parent charities to be involved. What a parent charity is can be quite various, and the link between the small charity and the parent charity, you know, can be quite sort of various. We work a lot with parent charities, for instance, in the field of non-submissions, where the smaller charities aren't submitting their accounts. That's a public fact. It's a fact that we publish, and that means we can engage with the parent charity. But we don't have specific powers to share information with parent charities in the way we do with other regulators or other statutory bodies. So in the case of an inquiry, we would have to look at that very much on a case-by-case basis. Sometimes it'll be the parent charity that's come to us with an issue, and you know, there'll be a degree to which we can engage with them. Sometimes the issue will be a dispute between the smaller charity and the parent charity, and there we have to step very carefully.
Okay, Thank you. Again, very helpful. I'll now move to questions from Jeremy Balfour.
Good morning and good morning, panel. Thank you all for coming. I wonder if I can maybe start with Alan, if that's okay with my first question. There have been some concerns raised in written evidence around the data protection implications of the bill. And I wondered, in the Law Society's view, are these adequately addressed within the DPIA and the legislative proposals, or do you think this still needs to be looked at further?
The first thing I would say is that my knowledge of data protection law is not very good. So I know about charity law, hopefully, but not that much about data protection, but of course the Society does. And so me commenting on that might not be the most helpful, but we have, from the Society's point of view, been very keen that when these proposals have been put in place, that in terms of security of information, the right information being publicly available, and of course the data protection regime that is in place is followed, and we would expect between the legislation and what Oscar is doing in practice ensuring that data is protected and is being looked after properly is going to be central to that. And again, it's part of the transparency and accountability is important, but that is going to be that public reassurance, and that would be eroded if the data was not being looked after in a proper fashion.
Okay, thank you. Maybe Martin, I mean, from a kind of regulator's perspective, are you happy with this kind of area of that we're dealing with?
Obviously, we are considering this very, very carefully, and what we are looking to do is to make sure that how we build the implementation, particularly around the trustee database, builds in compliance with data protection requirements. I mean, one of the things here is we will have a duty to collect this information, and that puts us in a particular place with data and data protection. But there will be specific safeguards in terms of how we collect information from charities. That will be in terms of the privacy notices that we issue to charity trustees. We will ask charity trustees to confirm the information that's been submitted on their behalf. We will have through the annual return mechanism that charities are used to submitting to us. We will ask charity trustees to have a yearly update and confirmation of the charity trustees, so that we can make sure that the data is accurate. And there will also be an easy online mechanism for charities to update trustee details after their AGM when they elect new trustees.
Thank you. John, I just wonder, anything we can learn from how it works down south in regard to this?
Certainly. I think overall, I would say it's not a kind of matter of concern, if you like. GDPR and data protection legislation is well known for being especially complex and technical. We work very hard to ensure that our work is compliant. But at a level of principle, data protection legislation is about ensuring a balance of rights and responsibilities between data controllers and data subjects. In the field of regulation, we talked already about transparency and accountability, public trust and confidence, and how regulators are given powers and duties to handle data in furtherance of those objectives. So I think to the extent that what is proposed here in the Scottish Bill matches arrangements that we already have in England and Wales, there are established understandings of how that works in terms of data protection. And I wouldn't have a concern at the level of principle, certainly.
Okay, thank you. My second question, and again, maybe start with Alan, but feel free to pass on. That is the terminology used within the bill, a connection with Scotland. And now I know there is some within the bill, that kind of gives some guidance in regard to that. My understanding, and it's only that there's no real clear definition of what this means. Again, from a Law Society perspective, from a legal perspective, are you happy with that terminology? Or do you think it should be more defined within primary legislation?
We recognise that defining that with great precision could be quite difficult to achieve. I suppose the idea here is that, you know, Oscar is going to be able to you know, consider things on a case by case basis to do that. So, you know, greater precision would be good. I suppose the difficulty is, well, what would that greater precision be, and would it capture the type of, you know, a situation that hasn't been considered that arises, and one that, you know, doesn't have a connection to Scotland but didn't fit into a very tightly constructed definition of a connection to Scotland.
I say this because I am one of those, and is this part of my book to the courts? So ultimately, will this have to be decided when someone takes this to a hearing? So is this primary legislation us plus my book to the judiciary? Or has that been unfair on us?
One thing, and Martin may have more insight on this, is how often this really crops up and what types of situations crop up. And certainly in my experience, charities that don't have an obvious connection to Scotland, when you drill down, do have some kind of connection to Scotland, and that becomes clear. What I'm not sure, and I say Martin might have that insight, is are the ones who just have no connection at all to Scotland, and you wonder why they have applied in the first place.
Martin, I don't know if you want to come in at that point.
Yeah, I mean, two things. I would comment that the bill sets out a bunch of things that we need to have regard to in looking at this, and it's a set of sort of characteristics of what a connection to Scotland might be. So it's having a physical footprint here, undertaking activities here, you know, having charity trustees here. That's actually very similar to provisions that are in the 2005 Act that we've been operating for a number of years in respect of the obligation to register as a charity here. And we have, you know, fairly clear guidance there, and we have a pretty settled idea of which we've been able to explain to the sector of how that operates. You know, as Alan, I think Alan's right, we're talking about where there would be uncertainty about that. We'd be talking about a very few marginal cases. And there is a bit at the bottom of those provisions that basically, you know, says, well, you know, we need to consider whether the connection is a negligible one. And I suppose that there is a bit of discretion for us to exercise around that, and we will need to think about how we would do that. But as someone who, you know, has to look at legislation and think about how to operate it quite a lot, this actually seems relatively detailed to me.
Okay, that's helpful. If I can move on, I mean, one of the powers that this bill, or when it becomes an act, would give is in regard to Oscar to be able to appoint interim charity trustees. And again, maybe, if that's okay, start with Alan and then come to Martin. And that is around, I mean, have you any concerns that this is a fairly large power that Oscar has, and do you think it's an appropriate power?
One aspect of this power is dealing with the situation where charities, quote-unquote, run out of trustees. There had been amendments in this area which gave Oscar powers, but not in the situation where you completely ran out of trustees. And you would be surprised how many trustee charities could accidentally run out of trustees. The Parliament will be looking at the Trust and Succession Bill soon, and that includes powers about how you change trustees. Under the current rules, if you don't follow what parliamentarians came up with in 1921 about changing trustees of a trust, you might accidentally run out of trustees, and then you have to go through a court process to get up and running again. This gives an Oscar process for dealing with that. So I think that's quite a sensible one, to allow a charity to sort of get back up and running in terms of its trustees.
Martin.
Yeah, I'd have very little to add to what Alan said there. It's a very circumscribed power, and essentially it is a power in very limited circumstances for us to be able to break a legal logjam to allow a charity to appoint to be able to appoint trustees, to allow a charity to deal with a problem that's in front of it, which will often be caused by a problem around quorum. It's a short-term measure.
the appointments are short term. So that's what I'd say there.
Yeah, fine. Okay, and my final question, and this really is for Martin. Obviously, when OSCE was originally started, their first appeal was to a separate tribunal. They now go to first tier tribunals. And this is maybe a question ringing for me. Have we actually ever disbanded officially, legally, the tribunals that were set up on, under the 95 Act? And just for clarity and tidy up, would that be an appropriate place to do it within this bill?
I'm sorry, but the answer is I don't know. I'd be happy to take that question away and try and give the committee an answer.
Thank you. I don't know if you know Alan either. Sure.
I have the same answer as Martin on that one.
Okay, if you could perhaps write to the committee after today, that would be really helpful. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Jeremy. I just have a few questions of my own before we finish, and I do apologise that we're running slightly on. We've had so much to get through. Do the panel have any concerns regarding the appointment of interim charity trustees? And are you satisfied that there is enough clarity around this provision? And should there be a dispute mechanism? Oh,
you got a question?
Apologies. Did you just cover that, Jeremy? Sorry, I have a few here. I'll move on to financial implications. Do witnesses agree that the bill proposals will not result in any additional costs for local authorities or charities? And I'll go to, I think perhaps Alan. Or...
We wouldn't see that the provisions in the bill will, cause, significant additional costs for the charity sector on the whole. As I say, some of the provisions that we would like to see in there would, they would save cost for charities.
Thank you. Does anyone have any other comments on that? Martin?
Just from me. I think where local authorities, local councils are acting as charity trustees of charities, they will have the same responsibilities as other charity trustees, so there will be the same burden. What I would say is that we've worked very successfully with a number of the local authorities to streamline their holdings of charities. So where they've been able to do that, then their costs will be proportionally lower. So it's probably much better than it would have been a few years ago.
Okay, thank you, Martin. And again, firing right back to you. We've touched on communication strategy briefly this morning and sort of around other themes, so I'd quite like something specific on that. So the SCVO highlighted that OSCR has a responsibility to ensure charity to understand the impact of the bill and noted that there is a possibility that the need for communication, engagement, guidance and clarification to charities as a result of the bill may have been underestimated. Is OSCR confident that you will be able to carry out your enhanced duties efficiently and effectively within the current levels of funding, or will further resources be required?
So, I mean, like other public bodies, we're looking to see how we can maximise efficiency with the resources we've got. But I think we do see that there will be a need for further resources here. That's both in terms of the digital changes that we'll need to make, and particularly in terms of the communications and engagement. And we're working with our colleagues in SG and with ministers to identify what those resources will be. That's on the basis of the financial memorandum and looking at our overall budget requirement as well.
Okay, thank you. And do you have any further comments just on that planned communications strategy should the bill be passed?
As I mentioned before, some of this will depend on commencements and phasing and things, but we are thinking very hard about a strategy and a campaign, particularly around, I think probably the areas that we've spoken about at the committee this morning, automatic disqualification, the trustee database, those things where it will impinge on the information and the charities provide to us and their interaction with us, and we want to do a lot of that very proactively and very upfront, both in terms of overall messaging to charities with the channels that we already have, but also that sort of specialised sector specific communication where we think that there may be specific issues. And obviously we're listening with great interest to what's coming out of these sessions in terms of where that might be.
Okay, Thank you very much, Martin, and thank you to all the panellists for giving your evidence this morning. I'll briefly suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to change over. Thank you again. Welcome back, everyone. I welcome to the meeting our second panel, Dr. John Picton, Senior Lecturer, Lecturer, Charity Law and Policy Unit, University of Liverpool. Nick Holroyd, Member, Faculty of Advocates. Gavin McEwen, Committee Member, Charity Law Association. And Keith McPherson, Member, ICAS Charities Panel, who all join us in the room today. As with the first panel, just a couple of very quick points to mention about the format of the meeting. Again, please don't feel you have to answer every question if you've nothing new to add. And again, we have a lot to cover, so just if you could keep your questions and answers as tight as possible. Again, we will begin the questioning today this morning with Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Some more questions as to the panel previously. So if you were here to listen, you'll know what's coming. Could the panel say a bit about the consultation that they've seen undertaken to get to the point in this with this bill, and what is your view on that consultation? I'll start with John.
Thank you. So the Charity Law and Policy Unit at Liverpool took part in both consultations, and we thought it was very thorough. The questions were clear and precise, and the agenda was clear. We noticed one of the initial sort of grounds in the consultation related to charities established by an Act of Parliament or charities established by a charter, and there were questions surrounding whether or not OSCA, the Scottish regulator, should be able to consent to constitutional changes at those charities, and that's been dropped. And we regretted that. We thought that was a shame. On that point, I'll briefly say that giving OSCA that power wouldn't necessarily mean deregulation. It would just mean giving OSCA the control. They can take a very strict view if they want to in relation to those types of charities.
Thank you. That's interesting. I think we've heard something similar on that from one of the witnesses last week. What about yourself, Nick?
Yes, I think there was general approval at the Faculty of Advocates end for the proposals which were being put forward, and the way in which matters were structured. There were various, I think, additional issues which are listed in the written submission, which may be worthy of consideration and a further review of charity law. But broadly speaking, it was a very positive response. There are certain individual suggestions which we make, but broadly there was a very positive response.
On the point of a further review, do you think there is a need for such a review, and what do you think it should include? And I see John nodding as well, so we'll note that. Thank you.
I think that there are a variety of issues which need to be looked at. One, I think, is the difficulty facing charity trustees in the broad sense of that term, where the charity through which they operate is a conventional trust, and the exposure to liability. I think that is a substantial issue which needs considered. And to some extent, a separate issue, but one which in practice interfaces with that, is the ability to change constitutions either on points of detail or changing the actual medium through which the charity body operates. So, for example, changing from a trust to a SCIO. So I think there are other suggestions made in the written submission as well.
Thank you. Gavin, do you have anything further to add?
So I would echo those comments. And I think just to pick up on John's point about the reorganisation of charities created under enactment or Royal Charter, these provisions wouldn't impact on a huge number of charities, but if there were provisions in the bill, they would make a meaningful difference to those charities. And so I think it's important to emphasise that it's not going to transform the entire sector, but it really would assist those bodies in making swift, cost-effective and cost-efficient constitutional changes. So for my part, I think it would be really good if that could be built into the bill during its progress. I do think a wider review is essential. There are lots of little technical things that lawyers and accountants, I'm sure, would bring along that is part of their wish list of things they'd like to see changed. But I think more interesting would be what the sector feels should change. And I think that really good sector engagement may flush out things that we haven't thought about and that Parliament hasn't thought about. So a really wide review, which really engages with the sector, I think would be an extremely valuable process.
Thank you. And we heard some evidence from the sector last week about that, and I think they would concur. Thank you. Keith, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, thanks. ICAS has responded to both the consultations. We've been satisfied with those exercises. We've also welcomed the opportunity to engage both with the Scottish Government's charity law team and OSCR themselves earlier this year, and see the OSCR's commitment within their own submissions and panel evidence that they will continue to engage with stakeholders through the implementation process of the bill. At a high level, we broadly welcome the proposals in the bill, recognising that it's a regulation and administration bill. I think in our own submission we have gone into some further areas around regulation that, as Gavin's touched on, in terms of a wish list for areas that could be done that we would like to have seen to go further, necessarily, I suppose, from our interest in terms of regulation and scrutiny, in terms of accounts and the audit and independent scrutiny of charity accounts, etc.
Thank you. I think there are further questions from my colleagues on that particular point to come. On sticking with the theme of the review and what's in the current bill on the basis of that, I think, John, you said in your submission that in order to bring it in line with UK regulation, there would need to still be a bit more in that. Do you feel that came out in the consultation? Do you think there are areas that would be part of this proposal or should be part of a broader review in regards to your comment about bringing it in line with other parts of the UK?
So thank you. So in England and Wales, there's just been a large-scale review of charity law, and that has led to some new differences between England and Wales and Scotland. And so, of course, there's a question there for Scotland to consider those differences and whether or not it wants to respond. I say that with some hesitancy because I'm not necessarily in favour of all the changes that have happened in England and Wales, but there have been changes. So, for example, it's now easier in England and Wales for trustees to change their own constitutions, so they have a power of amendment. It is now possible for trustees to sell goods to their own charity. So imagine I run a stationery factory and I can sell stationery to my own charity as a trustee. And there are questions there for Scotland as to whether or not it wants to respond to that.
Thank you. That's helpful. Where would you point us to have an understanding of the new differences that you refer to?
The Charities Act 2022 is coming into force in stages, so it's partially in force at the moment. And of course, the Charity Commission and its guidance. Yeah. And ourselves at the Charities Law and Policy Unit.
Thank you. That's much appreciated. And Gavin, it's my final question in this theme. The submission from yourself said that the law could go further. So notwithstanding the comment you made about reorganisation, which we've noted, are there any other areas that you think that have come out through the consultation that should be part of what's proposed now as opposed to part of a review in the future?
I think one of the joys of the Scottish charity system is that we've been slightly ahead of the game sometimes. So we beat England and Wales, if you want to be competitive for a moment, to in the introduction of charitable incorporated organisations. And we had them in Scotland before they had them south of the border. And that's been very nice to see that Scotland has been ahead of the game there in terms of charity law and regulation. I feel now we're slightly behind the curve. And I feel that this bill might put us slightly further behind the curve, and that would be my concern. So the Register of Mergers provision, for example, in this bill is really helpful and will allow us to catch up a bit with the system south of the border. But it covers only legacies and not lifetime gifts as well. And so I think there are subtle changes that could be made even to the bill as it stands, which would help to keep us either ahead of the curve or on the curve. And if that wider review can then capture more changes to really help the regime in Scotland to evolve and develop, then that will hopefully put us ahead of the curve again. And it shouldn't be a competition between jurisdictions, but I think we have done well in Scotland in the past, and it would be a shame if we lost that momentum.
Thank you. And you're a man that knows your audience, I think, in that regard. Thank you. Much appreciated. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much, Pam. Paul McLennan.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. A couple of questions, one for me. One is obviously in the general principles of the bill. It was around about provisions of, do they actually reflect the proposals brought forward by OSCR? in 2018, and does it support the regulatory role? And I think we asked that at OSCA themselves. And also, are the proposed extensions proportionate and appropriate at this time? And Gavin and Arno, you and I had that chat and we had that informal session. I don't know if you want, just for evidence obviously here, you want to just comment on that just now, and then I'll open up to see if anybody else wants to come in at that stage.
Yeah, I mean, I think in brief the answer is yes. I think it does pretty much achieve most of what Oscar had put forward as its wish list of changes. And the one key thing that's missing, as we've already mentioned this morning, is the provisions around charities created by enactment or Royal Charter, and it's a pity that that's been missed. In terms of the appropriateness or proportionateness of the proposals, I think that they are appropriate and proportionate. Oscar needs to be able to carry out its jurisdiction properly, and if it doesn't have decent powers to do that, it can't fulfil its obligations. And I think it's important also to remember that Oscar is under a duty to act appropriately and transparently and proportionately. So even if you introduced a disproportionate measure, Oscar would still have to comply with it in a proportionate manner. So the framework that we have should lead always to proportionate regulation, but I do think that what's in the bill is proportionate and appropriate.
Good. I don't know if anybody else wants to come on that one at all. No. Yeah, Casey.
Yeah, I mean, we would support the proposals, and particularly around the publication of accounts, register of trustee names. I know there would be more detailed questions probably in these areas, but I think all in all, we support these as increasing transparency and the accountability in the sector, and therefore, you know, and as long as that is undertaken proportionately, as has been talked about, then we're fully supportive of these measures.
But can you take some time, which leads nicely into the next question? And obviously, we're talking around about one of the key things, obviously, is transparency and accountability in the sector. Was there any weaknesses you think that were in the sector at that particular time? And I'll come to yourself first of all, Keith, in terms of that. And does the bill address these weaknesses?
I think weaknesses may be described as potentially too strong a word, but I think certainly, as we say, the full publication of unredacted accounts, maintaining a register of trustee names, all adds to that transparency, oversight. If you look at surveys of what builds public trust in charities, then being able to see how the money's been spent through obtaining the accounts, seeing who's in charge of charities, all of these are high up on the things that tick off those elements of public trust. And some of that, a lot of that information, if you're a charitable company, for example, that information is already in the public domain. So this is really just, we see as codifying that for, you know, good practice across the whole sector.
Okay. John, Nick, anything to comment on? And obviously Oscar and obviously the accountability and transparency side of things.
So thank you. Yes, so the bill's concerned with transparency and accountability and makes useful measures towards that. I think a very important feature, of course, is the publication of trustee names on the register, which goes to accountability. It's quite a constrained bill with a limited set of objectives. And so, of course, what is not is a review of all the possible ways in which law in Scotland could be improved.
I think you probably, I remember, maybe heard the discussion ongoing about whether there was a need for a further review, which I think seems to be the emerging view. Nick, anything to add on that?
Yes. Generally, again, a very positive view as to what's trying to be achieved, which is transparency and accountability. And to that, I would also add that some of the measures, in addition to doing that, will have possibly it could be described as a side effect. It will create a degree of discipline. So, for example, in relation to producing accounts, if there are rules on accounts which are proportionately, dare I say it, gently policed by Oscar, that will mean that there's a gentle pressure on trustees to get their accounts in order. Another area which I think has been mooted by the Faculty of Advocates is the idea of making the constitutions available, because then one can marry up the accounts, which would to some degree explain what has been done, and with the, for example, there's a summary of charitable objectives on the Oscar website. But if the constitutions were also published, that would, to some extent, I think, not only promote transparency but also create the sense of discipline amongst trustees? Do we need to change the constitution? Are we tempering what we're meant to be doing and so forth? So I think that would be a good idea. Where the faculty has reservations is in relation to having a public, wholly public register. The preference would be to have for charity trustees to have a voluntary decision on whether or not their names were made public. Part of that is inspired by practical considerations. I think one wants to make the environment for charitable trustees one which is appealing, and there can be all sorts of reasons why not having one's name in public might be appealing, and having it in public unappealing. And however well one has an appeal process, it's not going to be as good as having a starting point of it not being wholly public. It's not any suggestion that there shouldn't be a list of trustees, it just shouldn't be open to the world at large. And I think the second, sort of secondary to that, that sort of general idea is one which I suppose is one might call jurisprudential, but it's not an academic point, is that our issues to do with privacy, is the invasion, so you're giving all the information to the world at large, is that strictly necessary? And if it is necessary, how could it be done in a proportionate way? So it's that, almost that way of approaching matters. And the faculty written submission drew attention to a recent decision, a recent European Union case, which does show a slight rowing back from perhaps earlier thinking on the matter due to things like 9/11 and the concerns with terrorist funding and other horrors, very real horrors. There has been a desire to achieve transparency, but I think the faculty's position would be that if this can be done in a way which isn't giving the information to the world at large with potentially unknowable data implications, but nonetheless can be policed by Oscar and perhaps other people with legitimate interest in policing it, that would be the main point. If that approach isn't appealing, if the appeal, the process where one can make the application to not have one's name made public, I think needs very, very careful thought from a practical point of view, because there may be people who don't want any flicker for possibilities. They would need to be able to make a prior application, and that would also need to mesh with the way in which a particular charity selected its charitable trustees. So, I mean, some will be just assumed by the existing trustees, but some may have some form of election procedure. There could be all sorts of possibilities. So I think if the faculty's primary position is not acceptable, huge care needs to be taken to achieve the result. The European Union case mentions sort of risks of things like, which is concerned with beneficial ownership rather than trusteeship. It concerns with things like kidnapping, blackmail, harassment and so forth. Some of those are quite possible in a Scottish domestic context, but I think there are other possibilities. For example, one might have, if I can use a ghastly expression, a celebrity ex-convict, and that person might have rehabilitated, and he might be an excellent person to have on a suitable charity. But what the charity might want and what he might want to do is to help with that charity, ideally in the role of a trustee, not through his celebrity status, but through his real-world experiences.
Thank you. Gavin, anything to add?
I think from the Charity Law Association's point of view, we took a slightly different view from Nick. We felt that if there is to be complete openness and transparency, then the Register of Trustees is a very good starting point. So we felt that actually that is where we should begin in Scotland. Well, when I say begin, we're 17 years into the regime, but yeah, in terms of this bill. But it is right that people should be able to have their names taken off the register or not disclosed publicly if there are good reasons for that. I think what's important is that the messaging from OSCAR, because OSCAR will be the ones who deal with that process, that messaging needs to be very clear. So there's an understanding about how you go about the process of withholding your name and in what circumstances it would be acceptable. I think that's the most important point there.
Sorry, I suppose to add, we fully recognise the position of, I suppose, applying for dispensations and recognise that that can be an important thing. I think to note that under accounting regulations, the accounts of a charity need to disclose the names of the trustees unless such dispensation is in place, and the 2005 Act already requires effectively somebody can write to that charity and ask for a copy of the accounts with those trustee names to be provided to them. So to some extent a lot of that information is already available, if not okay. Perhaps listed on a register that can be associated directly, but it should be in the accounts anyway.
Okay. Thanks, Keith. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much, Paul. Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, panel. Good to see you. My first question is to Keith. ICAS highlighted in their submission that though some charities may feel daunted by the implementation of a register, these fears can be addressed through effective communication from OSCAR. And we did touch that previously. What do you think effective communication would look like?
Thank you. Yes, and I suppose I've had some advantage in listening to what their plans for that communication were earlier and may have answered some of those elements. I suppose, yes, we said it may seem daunting, and I suppose that was about something that may seem new and different, notwithstanding my previous comments just now about the fact that their information is in the accounts. But yes, so to that extent, I think it is very much about communication. Where we saw that going as obviously providing some idea about timescales for the rollout and how that would be captured within, for example, the online OSCAR online system for reporting of the annual return and the timelines for doing that. I think we obviously saw how the need for and potentially guidance on use of that digital system, if it was going to be, and as necessary, any kind of offline alternatives where that online could be seen as a hindrance or a barrier. We obviously heard from OSCAR earlier that, in fact, they feel that there's very good engagement on the online system and that isn't seen as too much of a barrier. I think we welcome the fact that the annual return process becomes a kind of statutory requirement, and so that becomes an obvious point that charities can get involved in. And I think another element, I suppose, maybe just also to make sure there's communication out there to kind of alleviate or potentially explain any concerns that trustees may have for non-compliance or timescales for compliance in terms of changes and timescales for reporting and what does it mean if they don't comply because they overlook the timeline. So I think including those elements would be what we would see as the necessary requirements for communication.
Okay, thanks for that, Keith. And my next question is to John. Liverpool University said dispensation should be allowed, and we've kind of talked about dispensation, but not in too much detail so far. In situations where trustees can demonstrate a risk of personal danger, John, what do you think that criteria might look like?
So thank you. So in the legislation, you can have your name kept off the register for safety and security concerns. So that I take to be targeted at people who are in some way vulnerable or publicity might lead to personal threats. An open question is whether or not it should go further, but that's a high threshold. So it's certainly not, for example, and again, this is just something to think about, professional embarrassment. It's not something broad, otherwise disadvantaged beyond safety and security.
Okay. I don't know if anyone else wants to come in on that. Gavin.
I mean, I think some of the examples were touched on in the earlier session of today's committee meeting. So thinking about charities involved in domestic abuse, for example, where users of the service might also serve as trustees. They bring a really valuable skill and lived experience. And it's very, very important to capture that. But if that might put them at risk because they are suddenly much more visible as a trustee, then that needs to be managed. And there are other examples like that. We talked about the rehabilitation of offenders in the earlier session as well. That kind of situation, I think, is important to be managed. So the regulatory framework needs to allow that to be managed properly.
Yes, I think we're to some extent back to the issue of whether trustees' names should be made public. And I'm just glancing at the European Union case, and the risk of repeating myself, mention is made of risk of fraud, kidnapping, blackmail, extortion, harassment, violence or intimidation. And in addition to that, I've made the suggestion that there might be this other issue that you might want someone who was high profile, but not want them because they were high profile, but for their actual experience or skill set. I suppose the other issue, which is perhaps more to do with the almost into the realms of questions of whether or not something is necessary or disproportionate, if given that OSCO would have the list of trustees' names, even if they weren't publicly accessible, if there was an option to make them publicly accessible, so if the charity or the individual could choose to make them publicly accessible, I suppose OSCO could police those charities where the names weren't being made public with particular vigilance. And there are obviously charities, I think, were references to women's refuges, where the names may not be made public and the addresses may not be made public. It would be interesting to know whether in those circumstances where names and other details have been kept out of the public domain, whether there have been any particular problems. And the flip side of that coin is that if charities thought that having their names made public was a, for want of a better expression, a good public relations position, and they might well take that into account as well. But I say the tiered approach, which is favoured, that there would be no obligation to make the names public, is the primary one.
Thank you. That's me, convener.
Thanks very much, Evelyn. Moving online now to Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning, panel. Before I ask the question, I think I should declare my interest. I'm a co-chair of charitable organisation, ELREC. My first question will be to Gavin and John. Do the witnesses have any concern that this would disproportionately affect smaller charities, particularly ethnic minority charities that are already struggling to stay in business given the cost of living crisis?
So I think my own thoughts from the Charity Law Association's considerations, we are not overly concerned that this bill places an undue burden on charities. I think we appreciate that there's quite a lot for charity trustees to get their head around in terms of new rules and regulation and requirements, but we don't see that as a fundamental barrier for most charities. And I think with sufficient support and education of the sector, both from OSCAR and other umbrella bodies, that ought to be manageable. So we don't have undue concerns. I do think that some parts of the sector will struggle, though, given that there are particular pressures through inflationary cost of living issues. I think we just have to accept that's part of a wider social problem just now, but I don't think that flows from the bill itself.
Thank you very much. Does John want to say anything on that?
Yes, briefly. Thank you. So I think on small, amateur, entirely voluntary charities, the bill does impose frictions rather than than costs. So I don't think it costs them money necessarily, but it does mean, of course, that they have to be organised. There has to be somebody organising the conveyance of the information to Oscar. You'd expect that, even in a small charity. But it is, of course, the case that it does impose frictions.
Thank you very much. My second question is probably for Nick. Do the witnesses have any concern regarding the provision for charities to reject certain information from published accounts where there might be safety or security concerns?
I think that's an extremely good question. I think the opportunities for redacting information with the approval of Oscar is a good one. For example, some accounts, as we've already heard, would disclose the information of trustees, and there might, one way or another, be a desirability of not having them named, or it might indicate the location where certain charitable purposes were being fulfilled, for example, back to the women's refuge. So I do think there is scope for redaction. And again, one's hope would be that there would be the opportunity to liaise with, for the charity trustees to liaise with Oscar to find some acceptable landing zone for both the charity and for Oscar, rather than necessarily make it contentious. And I think Oscar's generally done a very good job in that approach. On top of that, the Oscar website and indeed the equivalent English body's website are very, very helpful and no doubt good. They're already very good, but no doubt there's always scope for additional materials. As these, perhaps a publication on the circumstances about what things you might think about wanting to redact and liaise with Oscar over. So I think that is a really fantastic point.
Because being involved in third sector organisations, and I always found that security concern is the main issue for the trustees. Thank you very much for the answer. I think I'll go on to, I don't know if anybody else wants to get in on that question.
Keith?
Yeah, Keith? I suppose if I just may say, I think, we support, and it links back to my previous comments about the accounts requirements, including names and disclosure of names, then we are fully supportive that it is just a proposal to publish names of individuals and not other associated personal information like addresses, etc., and those things. So, and notwithstanding some very specific cases where dispensation should also be in place.
Thank you very much. I think my next question will be for all the panel members. As you probably know, that majority of the third sector small organisations are very limited with numbers of people, and majority of the trustees are volunteers. What support is provided to the organisations? And I'll start from you, Keith. There's any support can be because there is loads of work involved.
Yeah, I suppose in terms of thinking about the provisions for some of the smaller charities and concern of whether there's a duplication of efforts around maintaining registers of trustees or those elements and restoring that. I suppose one area that we've considered is to what extent Oscar's register itself may provide the means to support some very small organisations to have that detailed information contained securely in what we would presume would be a secure GDPR compliant means of having their listing of trustees available, and therefore supporting their own governance in terms of maintaining that list of their trustees, etc., and potentially supporting best practice for them. So we see that potentially could have a positive for some smaller organisations who struggle to maybe maintain that information themselves.
Thank you very much. if anybody else wants to get involved. And
the comments made by Keith are again very much in point. If there is a database, an accessible database of charities, and for example, gooding mergers and, say, hypothetically, constitutions, it might in some circumstances be possible for one charity to find out how another charity has dealt with a particular problem, be it tweaking the constitution or something much more practical. So I can see that the idea of indirect benefits arising from the register.
Thank you very much, Convener. I don't have any other question.
Thank you, Faisal. Now move to Deputy Convener Emma Roddick online.
Thank you, Convener. My first question here is for Keith. I know that most of the discussion around whether it's important or sensible to have the same disqualification criteria across the UK is focused on the comparison to England and Wales, but I was interested to see Northern Ireland mentioned in your submission. Could you expand on why you feel it's important to have consistent disqualification in different jurisdictions, and whether there are particular interactions with Northern Ireland that the committee should consider?
I believe the submission was as much to point out that it's not we're not just talking two jurisdictions. Northern Ireland has its own elements that are different. Again, I think in that respect, bearing in mind, some aspects of it's not about pure alignment, but I suppose, some charity trustees will not necessarily, because you're a Scottish charity, your charity trustees or senior management won't necessarily only be trustees of a Scottish charity. They may also be trustees of other organisations, and therefore some, I think it seems eminently sensible that the same disqualification criteria are in place across those jurisdictions. And I think our submission wasn't, I think, particularly pulling out Northern Ireland, but just to note that it was, another jurisdiction to reference in that sense. Beyond that, much more of that, I think the requirements in terms of what the criteria are speak more into the legal aspects, and I would probably defer to other panel members to go into more detail on that.
I think from the Charity Law Association's point of view, I would simply point to what Martin Tyson from OSCAR said in the earlier session in today's committee meeting. I think that he made clear why there were benefits in having a consistent structure so far as possible across the UK. And I think that does make sense, particularly where there are cross-border charities. It's important there that the disqualification rules are the same and are as uniform as possible. I don't see the need for the rules to be expanded, particularly in Scotland, in a different way. And I'm not particularly familiar with the setup in Northern Ireland, but I think if we can have as much consistency as possible, that does actually help the third sector to manage disqualifications in a practical way.
Thank you. And if I can go to Nick to pick up on something that we were discussing earlier with Martin. Is it appropriate for OSCAR to maintain this publicly searchable record of trustees who have been disqualified? And do you think this presents any issues around the handling of sensitive personal data?
If I can take it in two stages, generally I think it's important that there is a register of disqualifications which is available to OSCAR. And I think I'm probably speaking for myself rather than the faculty. I would be sympathetic to that being made publicly available, and whether or not it gives rise to issues akin to rehabilitation of offender type matters, I would need to think about quite carefully. I don't know the answer to that. So that is an additional issue. As I say, it could be some analogy with rehabilitation of offenders and not making those matters public after a certain time. But in substance, there certainly should be a register, and I'm personally sympathetic to being public, but I can see that you've raised an interesting question about potential legal complications if it is made public. The other matter on disqualification, which the faculty makes the point, is there will be some benefit in actually having a declaration, for example, in the accounts that there are no disqualified people in trustee positions or senior management positions. But the analogy with rehabilitation of offenders and that type of issue is one I don't have a settled view on, and I don't think the faculty expressed a view on that in the written submission. But that is a point worth exploring.
You've preempted my next question there, actually, because I was going to pick up on the declaration. Could you expand on why that would be helpful, in your view, in addition to this register? And could you clarify whether this would force charities to declare that nobody has ever been disqualified, even if they do not currently appear on that register?
Well, the part of the inspiration for having the declaration was the idea that the charity trustee name might not be available. And so that would be some assurance to those dealing with the charities that there was there has been some, as it were, vetting of the charitable trustees, and that declaration would sit with that. Again, I also think it would be a good thing to have, even if the names are available. As far as the time period is concerned, I think neither I nor the faculty, I think, has got a view on that. Again, it's a matter which is worth exploring. Should it be, say, 5 years, or because people do get rehabilitated, and that's a very positive thing. And bad experiences can give rise to insights and lead to people being able to do valuable things in the future. So perhaps the idea that someone should never be someone who's never been a charitable trustee, someone who has been disqualified should then never be a charitable trustee, I think would be going too far. There was an interesting comment which I half overheard earlier in the morning, and that was made in relation to bankruptcy, and the suggestion was that bankruptcy wasn't someone who had been bankrupt could later go on to become a charitable trustee. So I do think there's scope for people who've had misadventures to make a useful contribution at a later date.
That brings me on quite nicely, actually, to one of the next things I wanted to ask.
Sorry, Emma, I know that you're on a flow there, but I just know that Gavin had wanted to come in that specific point, so if I could just interrupt you for a second.
Thank you very much, convener. I did just want to support what Nick was saying there, but also to add that for lots of charities, when you're considering whether potential trustees have actually been disqualified or are perhaps currently disqualified at the time of their appointment, you're really taking that on trust, because you only have the charity trustee's word for that unless you're able to carry out other due diligence. In the context of a charitable company, you can search against the register of disqualified company directors, but for any other kind of trustee, you don't have that ability. So without a list of disqualified or a register of disqualified trustees maintained by OSCAR, it's very difficult for charities to carry out any additional due diligence at all. So this is something which currently is taken on trust, and I think that the availability of a register, which would need to be managed properly, is actually a help to charities.
Thanks, Gavin. And Emma, if you would like to continue, apologies.
That's okay, convener. So earlier in last week's session, we did hear concerns that the disqualification criteria might disproportionately impact certain demographics, and particularly charities working within sectors where lived experience is valued and might become a barrier if this criteria is applied. Does anybody share those concerns in the room today?
Possibly. There's a point to make about uniformity in the United Kingdom in terms of having the same disqualification criteria. And a separate point about dispensation, which could be much softer and done by Oscar on a policy basis. So question about dispensation for people with undischarged convictions or bankruptcy could be done informally. That said, it's important to note that a regulator doesn't have much incentive to give dispensations to people with a record of dishonesty to take a position of trustee, because the regulator themselves is then taking on some sort of culpability or responsibility, at least, I should say. So in those circumstances, there should perhaps be very clear guidance around the circumstances in which Oscar would be prepared to give dispensation to someone who's been disqualified.
Would any other of the other panelists like to come in? No? Oh, Nick?
I think the point about lived experience is very important. I suppose ideally, in most charities, you want to have a mixture of people. So, you know, someone with financial insights and someone who knows the territory where the purposes are going to be fulfilled, the charitable purposes are going to be fulfilled. Earlier, again, there was a very helpful comment made earlier this morning making the point that even if someone can't be a charity trustee or a very senior manager, they could nonetheless make a valuable contribution to the charity. So they could be a less senior employee, or they could, or have a voluntary role. As far as dispensations are concerned, the other matter which crosses my mind, and it's an off-the cuff type thought, is there might be scope for allowing somebody to take on a senior management role or a trustee, probably more obviously a trustee role, but restrict the type of activities which they're involved. To give a very crude example, you might be happy for someone who's had an unfortunate past to do with money type irregularities. You might be less concerned if they had a role as assistant secretary than if they were treasurer, and you might feel less anxious if they had no access to, using very old-fashioned language, signing the cheques. So I think it could be quite a flexible regime, and one could even see people progressing from one role to, so for example, being a volunteer and then becoming a manager and then becoming a charity trustee with restrictions on them.
Thank you.
That makes a lot of sense, and we did hear from Martin earlier on similar lines in terms of there maybe being scope for exceptions where it makes sense. But would that present challenges, Nick, in terms of charities meeting your suggestion of being able to make a declaration? Would that not cause problems if there were?
It would undoubtedly complicate that picture, and I suppose that they would have to say, unless they got a dispensation for making the dispensation, they would have to make it clear they couldn't, in good faith, say no one on this panel has been on this, none of the charity trustees have been disqualified or whatever the declaration was. They obviously couldn't say something which wasn't true. But I don't think that would necessarily be a complete barrier, because they could in the narrative, it might make it unappealing to certain people wishing to make donations. They might say, we have someone who is a reform convict and he has got a limited role. And that could be something which could be made explicit. It might put people off giving funds, but that would be something which would have to be balanced. Again, I would hope that there could be a liaising between, or I should say amongst, the Oscar, the charity, and the individual concerned. It is important to get people with lived experience actually doing active things within charities.
Thank you, Emma.
And that's all my questions, Convener.
Perfect, Emma. Thank you very much. Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning. The changes proposed in the bill would allow OSCA to investigate former charities and their trustees, and I wanted to ask a couple of questions with regards to that and whether or not the panel think it is appropriate for OSCA to be able to issue positive directions following that inquiry work. Who wants to start on that, Gavin?
Yeah. I think it is important that OSCA can investigate former charities and former charity trustees. Former charities, because the body might still exist and might therefore still have assets which are subject to use restrictions under Section 19 of the 2005 Act. And it's important that OSCA has the ability to police those funds, in effect, to ensure that they're not at risk. So that is important. In terms of former charity trustees, I think it's also important that OSCA has those powers, because what we don't want to find across the third sector is that people simply leave a charity from their role as a trustee in order to escape liability. And at the same time, are perhaps nevertheless trustees of other charities. And if there's a pattern of behaviour, a pattern of misconduct which needs to be managed, then OSCA needs to have the ability to step in. So I think it is proportionate for OSCA to have those powers. I think it's important for the instilling of public confidence in the sector.
Yeah, thank you. Anyone else have any points?
It might be reasonable to ask OSCA to explain, perhaps reduce guidance on the circumstances in which they'd like to use the positive power. I was struck that there hasn't been much explanation of the circumstances in which the power might be used. And so while it does seem reasonable and proportionate, it is quite difficult to see what its function is.
Thank you for that.
Okay. Yeah, I think I would primarily we would support most of what Gavin said, and so I just wanted to confirm that. I think for all the reasons there, the ability to do that investigative work for former charities, former trustees, would demonstrate the ability of the regulator for good governance, etc. I think potentially having sat in one of the informal sessions around, I think the clarity in a sense that the power around positive directions comes after undertaking inquiries and therefore making decisions based on that and having engaged with the charity, I think is a key point about it, and that and maybe hadn't been fully understood up until that, in terms of maybe some charities thinking that this was going to be an ability to do a kind of positive directions that would affect a large number of charities as a kind of blanket power or something. So I think that'll be a key part of the kind of communication process going on.
Yeah, thank you. We've also heard with regards to designated religious charities that in some cases, church acts and constitutions go further than the bill currently. So I just wanted to ask whether or not the panel believe it's appropriate for designated religious charities to be exempt from this provision, and if there's any points they want to make around that as well. Nick, did you want to come in there?
In the faculty's written submissions, this was a matter which we considered and ultimately thought it was probably better that the designated religious charities point was considered under fuller review. There was an initial, so in discussions there was a thing, well, why should one group get treated specially compared to another? But there was a slight anxiety that there might be something being missed. Was there some constitutional issue to do with the separation of church and state or something? I'm putting it very grandly, but it was just a feeling there might be something there which wasn't obvious as to why one group should be treated differently from another. So I think it was a suggestion it should go into a further review process.
Thank you. Sorry, Gavin, did you want to comment on that?
I think just to add that obviously designated religious charities having their own structures means that hopefully they can actually police any areas of difficulty, including misconduct. So from that point of view, having a slightly different regime for them works. But it's fair to say that amongst the members of the Charity Law Association, there are some members who are very against the idea of separate treatment for DRCs. And I think if it were to come out in a future review, some of our members would not be particularly disappointed.
Thank you for that. Has anyone else got any other points? No. If not, hand back to yourself, Convener.
Thank you, Miles. And Jeremy Balfour.
Good morning again, and thank you for coming. Obviously, you've heard the questions before, so I'm just going to go through the same ones that I dealt with the first panel. First, around data protection implications, and I don't know whether Keith has any comments around this, around the data protection stuff.
Actually, not really to make in this. It's not an area that ICAS has considered in any great detail, and so we wouldn't look to make detailed comment.
Okay. Gavin?
I think two brief points. One is that there is a whole body of law on data protection, and I've no reason to suspect that OSCAR wouldn't comply with that. And the other point is that, in my experience, OSCAR is already very responsible with the data that it handles. And how it's used, how it's controlled, and how it's released, if it has to be released. I have no particular qualms personally on how OSCAR would comply with the data protection rules, but it is simply a matter of compliance, and the rules are there to give that framework.
Thank you. I don't know whether Nick or John have any comments. Nick.
Again, I wouldn't claim to be an expert in data protection, but I would renew the anxiety about having some information, such as names, which is available to the world at large, and also pick up on the point which was raised in questioning, and the idea of redacting information, having liaising with OSCAR over what sort of information should be redacted so it didn't rise to risks. But I don't think I've got any specific points on data protection beyond that.
And then just moving on in regard to the connection with Scotland, obviously we have two lawyers in the room and a lecturer. Are we happy with the definition for the connection with Scotland? Should it be tighter, or do you think this will help us move forward? Nick, I'll start with you from the faculty.
I would think this may be something which should be kept under review, and if it gives rise to problems, that may be something which needs to be tweaked. I don't think I have any views on how it should come into life at the present time, but it might be something which could be dealt. I'm just trying to think how mechanically that could be dealt with, if there would be a mechanism to have an easy way of reviewing how it was working in practice. One matter related to that was that the faculty considered slightly mischievously whether there should be a requirement at all, or whether it might be a good source of business for Scotland to regulate other charities, and ultimately came to the conclusion no, there should be a Scottish connection requirement, because it would be not least because it would be difficult to police. But I think the idea of keeping under review how something works in practice would probably be the best way of dealing with it.
Thank you. If I can move on, I mean, one of the powers that OSCAR will get, if this becomes legislation, is the appointment of interim trustees. Obviously, we heard the evidence previously on that. I'm just wondering again if there's any practical concerns around this in regard to how this might work, and just looking to see if are we all happy with that, Gavin?
I think it's right that OSCAR should have the power to appoint interim trustees where there's a particular difficulty that needs to be tackled in a particular charity. I think for me the practical issue is, where will OSCAR find those interim trustees? Yep. And for some charities it's difficult enough to find their own trustees without looking to OSCAR to appoint interim trustees. I guess that's a problem for OSCAR rather than for Parliament or for us. But that is in the back of my mind, a difficulty around the system.
Yep. A fair point. Nick?
Following up from Gavin's point, is the question of expense, as to who would bear the expense of the interim trustee. Because if it was, for example, a professional person, that would presumably be a paid professional person, unless there was a panel of volunteers who were going to be prepared to be appointed to suitable interim positions.
Thank you. I mean, my final question, again, maybe just start with Gavin on this one. I mean, obviously, when OSCA was set up, one of the first purposes it was meant to have done was review really every Scottish charity to see if it was fit for purpose. Now, that has taken a long time, not absolutely sure how well that has been achieved, mainly due to lack of resources and other things coming in. I mean, how confident are we that what has been asked to be implemented here can actually be achieved with the resources that OSCA have at the moment? Or are we actually in danger of shutting an organisation up to fail?
Obliging OSCA at the outset to review every charity on the register was quite a noble aim. And I think with its limited resources, it's simply an impossible task, and a task that would never end because new charities are added constantly to the register. What the bill does is allow OSCA to carry out a review of any charity that it sees fit to review. I think that's better because it allows randomised checks to be made. But I think that original noble aim is simply unrealistic. OSCA would need a lot more financial resource and person power to be able to carry that out.
Okay. And John, can I just ask you, I mean, again, from a kind of good practice, is this something we should be asking OSCA to do more of investigation, or do you think the balance is about right what we have at the moment?
So OSCA has come to you and effectively asked for a suite of new powers, and they all seem they're technical powers, but they seem broadly proportionate. But you're of course right. You can give your regulator as many powers as you want. The question is always one of resources.
Okay. Thank you, Camina.
Thanks, Jeremy. And I'll just finish with one final question. Do the witnesses agree that the bill proposals will not result in any additional costs for either local authorities or charities? Gavin, I'll perhaps direct that to yourself.
Yes, I think in theory most charities shouldn't really feel much cost here. There is a bit of compliance work to be done. There's a bit of resource that will need to be applied by charities. I think the cost implications ought to be minimal for most charities, and certainly for us at CLA, we did not have a particular concern around that.
Okay, thank you. John, I'm not sure if you've got anything to add. I was going to come to you next on that.
On costs, no, I would agree with that. Frictions, but not costs, and I think the frictions are appropriate.
Okay, perfect. All right, thank you very much, everyone, for your evidence this morning. Next week, we will continue to take evidence in the bill when we hear from the Cabinet Secretary. That concludes our public business for today. We will now move into private, and can members who are joining us remotely please use the Teams link in their calendars to join the meeting. Thank you.